I'm Glenda Sean. This is my persuasive speech for November for Adam Paulson. Every year, about 40,000 babies are born with symptoms of prenatal alcohol exposure. These symptoms vary in severity and may include physical defects, cognitive defects, and behavioral problems. Many children with prenatal alcohol exposure need special education services, and few are able to live on their own as adults. Some become involved in criminal activity and are incarcerated. The annual national cost for medical and residential treatment is estimated at $42 million. These costs include neonatal care and other treatments, and care up to 21 years of age, including food, housing, support services, special education, and loss of productivity. This isn't including the cost for such thing as medical services for physical anomalies that need to be fixed, such as vision, kidneys, or genital tract problems, dental, or the cost of anesthesiologists to have them come in and do the surgeries while these children are in the hospital. And also, that's not counting welfare payments to the families or the criminal justice, which is another $20,000 approximately a year, and the loss of productivity of the caregivers of these children and for the persons with the fetal alcohol syndrome. My speech today will point you in a direction you may not have considered before in solving this issue. I will provide you with information and facts to help you see why it is so vital that we take on an active role in ending this epidemic. Fetal alcohol syndrome is defined by the dictionary as a pattern of birth defects occurring as a result of excessive alcohol consumption by the mother during pregnancy and characterized by growth retardation, cranial, facial, or neural abnormalities, and development disabilities. So fetal alcohol syndrome totally sounds preventable to me. So why should women who have one child that is diagnosed with fetal alcohol syndrome be allowed to have more children? That's my question to you today. There are all kinds of government-funded programs to help these women to stop abusing alcohol. And they certainly could access those programs before they got pregnant another time. We have a free country. We have a free choice to where we want to live, what we want to work at, and whether we want to go to school or not, and how many children we wish to have. When do we say as a society that we need to stop and stand up for the unborn child? How many children will we allow these women to have when they clearly show that they have not stopped drinking? Once that child is born, we may apprehend the child and protect them. But for that child, it's too late. They will suffer with the side effects for a lifetime. We are going to take a look at some of the characteristics of fetal alcohol syndrome and to show you why we must do something to stop this unnecessary affliction that children, and then later on as adults, they have to live with and face. As part of the syndrome, symptoms, and let's have a look at, I have a picture here that I'd like you to look at. Now, if you have a look here, some characteristics are the small head, the short eyelid opening, the flat mid-face, the smooth philtrum, the underdeveloped jaw, thin upper lip, a short nose, and these folds on the eyes, and a low nasal bridge. That's just an example, and usually these characteristics won't usually show up until they're between the ages of 2 to 10. So when they're born, a lot of these facial features won't be visible. And in about 20% of children show the facial features. So they're diagnosed with full fetal alcohol syndrome. For those that don't show many of the physical characteristics in the face, they go undiagnosed, and that's about 80% of the kids. So they're partial fetal alcohol But just because they don't have the physical characteristics, they still suffer with the neurological damage that's been done to them. Now, some of the other symptoms that may these children may exhibit, and later as adults, is extreme mood swings, impulsivity, diminished judgment, attention deficit, lack of normal self-discipline, irresponsibility, and different and lacking social cues, like where they'll trust people that they really shouldn't, and they're really inappropriate behavior in social settings. Along with the poor judgments, these kids usually trust people that they shouldn't, so they end up as abused children or teenagers, and they're targets for gang-related activity. So we went through some of the physical characteristics already. The most serious characteristics are the invisible symptoms, which a lot of them I've already just mentioned. But then there's also the inability for them to manage their money. So for these kids to grow up and live on their own and live a normal lifestyle, it's nearly impossible. They don't have the problem-solving skills. They have difficulty learning from their previous consequences. They have immature social behaviors, lack of control over their emotions, and very poor judgment. So as teens and adults, they have trouble staying in school, keeping or getting a job, or sustaining healthy relationships. Without appropriate support systems, these individuals have an increased risk of developing secondary disabilities, such as mental health issues, getting into trouble with the law, abusing alcohol and other drugs, and more unwanted pregnancies. And then the cycle repeats itself all over again. Children and adults with FAS are quite vulnerable to physical, sexual, and emotional abuse. What kinds of relationships will they have in their life? I worked at a facility for juvenile youth, and over 85% of the boys that were in that home were diagnosed with fetal alcohol syndrome, and 90% of them came from homes with alcohol or drug abuse. These effects are not temporary. They're not reversible. They are a life-lasting syndrome that can't be changed once it's done. So I give you, this is my plan of action, and I propose it to you today, and I hope you will also see the importance in this. Number one, I believe that unless a woman proves that she has been through rehabilitation and has stopped abusing alcohol, she should be made to use mandatory birth control. Whether it be a depot shot where she has to come into the clinic, where she cannot be, where she is non-compliant with taking a birth control pill every day, she can get a shot every 3 months to prevent pregnancy, unless she chooses a method to be compliant with. The second thing I propose is that if they're already pregnant the second time and they're abusing alcohol, they should be court ordered to spend the rest of their pregnancy either in a hospital or a rehab center, where they do not have the option of coming in contact with alcohol and where they'll receive proper nutrition for the rest of that pregnancy. And the third thing is, after having two children diagnosed with fetal alcohol syndrome and no signs of rehabilitation on the mother's part, I believe that she should be forced to have a permanent form of birth control, whether that is a tubal ligation, because at this point it's not for herself, it's for the children, that the unborn children that will suffer for the rest of their life. Number four, I think we can do something to change legislation. I will be passing around a pamphlet and a petition that we can all sign and give to our local member of parliament, that he would be hear the voice of the concerned citizens. And the fifth one is, we do sex education in the schools. Well, we should also include a real teaching where someone suffering with fetal alcohol syndrome comes in and speaks to those kids and shows them what having unprotected sex and alcohol abuse at the same time will cause that child to suffer. So in conclusion, I am sure all of you know someone who personally has suffered with FAS. Now compare the cost of a 9-month treatment facility to the lifetime cost of everything I have mentioned for that unborn child and what he will have to go through. Do you think mandatory controls and treatment are comparable to a lifelong battle with FAS and no cure? I believe this is the solution to an epidemic in our society, one we can no longer ignore. Thank you.